Hello students, we'll be continuing with the fundamentals of information technology, unit 1, and today we'll be discussing the topics of classification of computers and computer system. So there are many types of classifying the computers. So one of the types that we used to do is based on the size and the speed of the computer. So the first classification in this is the microcomputer. Microcomputer is a small computer. It's not actually that fast and that costly. And it can be used in homes, offices for individual use by one person. And so it is also called as personal computers. So it has a basic computer that whatever you have seen, like keyboard, mouse, CPU, monitor, etc. So this includes desktop computer, laptop computer, palm top and handheld computer. As I told you, there are different ways of classifying the computers. So we are classifying this based on size and speed. So example for this is IBM PC, Pentium 100 and Apple Macintosh. Next is a mini computer. So, we describe this with the reference to the previous one and with reference to the next computer that is in the context. So, first is, if this is smaller than mainframe, that is the next type, but it is bigger than the microcomputer. And it can be used by many people at the same time. It is not as expensive as mainframe, but it is not even as fast as mainframe. So it is used in kind of universities, polytechnics, techniques, companies, etc. It's about the size of a refrigerator, you can say. And the main purpose of this is a scientific research, and also it's used in banks and large organizations. Especially this ATM, all these things come in this mini computers. So example is PDP-11, IBM 8000 series, etc. So the next one is mainframe computer. In the mainframe, we have, it is like, you know, it is a larger than the mini computer and it has a huge capacity and it is used in large businesses or government organization to perform complex tasks. So bulk data processing like sensors, industry and consumer statistics, enterprise resource planning, ERP and transaction processing can be done through this mainframe computers. And again, it's as big as a closet. And they're mostly used for large business and scientific research. Example, IBM's ES000, VAX8000, CDC6000, etc. Next one is a supercomputer, and this is the biggest and the most powerful and the fastest computer. So if you see the difference between the previous one and this one is, the previous one works largely in multitasking, like it is not made for a single purpose. Many tasks you can perform together and it is quite fast and it is quite speedy in processing. Whereas supercomputer, of course, it's very fast in processing, but it is actually made for a single task. For example, if one supercomputer we take, it is used for like, maybe used for weather forecasting. The other one may be used for nuclear power stations and military simulations, research laboratories, animation movies, anything. But one computer will be used for a specific purpose. CD3, Cyber 205, VRAM are some of the example of this supercomputer. So next is the computer system. Students, we all know what the computer system has or what a computer typically has. But whatever we see to our eyes, it's not just the computer that actually works inside. So the thing is, these individual parts has even subparts which works in a specific way. Their works are different and they are given with the specific tasks. So when we see the computer, the main thing, or like, you know, the brain of the computer, we have heard it as a central processing unit. Why? Because the calculation part or the controlling part or whatever the things, the commands are given are understood by the CPU and then it is processed. So CPU forms the main unit of this total computer system. So it has three subparts again, like arithmetic and logic unit, control unit and registers. Arithmetic and logic units, as you all know, it performs the arithmetic calculations, and logic unit, it has a logical operations like AND OR operations that you have studied or you will be studying in your CVAO. Next is the control unit. Why this control unit? See, you have input devices, you have output devices, you have monitor, you have printer. But how will the computer know when to act and how? This is, even if the input is given by the input device, the computer has to know how to regulate it, right? How to control it, like when the input has to be given. Even if the input is given at the time it is not to be taken, then where will that input go? And if at all you given output, or the output will be given by the system, how it will be received by the user, how will the user get it, either it's a monitor or it's a printer. So these things are decided according to the user instructions, of course, but the controlling is done by the control unit of the central processing unit. The other things are the registers. Registers are like, you know, a memory which perform with a very high speed, and their purpose is to store the information then and there. Like, it never stores the information for a long term, but when the calculation has just happened or when the information has just to be stored, for that small amount of time, very small amount of time, it is stored in registers. And there are different kinds of registers which has a different purpose. So that will be studying in detail in the coming classes. Next is the input unit. You know, students, there are many input devices, but the main one we say are the keyboard and the mouse. So there are many others like joystick, or even your microphone can be an input device. So all these are input devices. And you know what output devices also. Output devices include your monitor, printer, or a speaker. So all this comes under an output unit. One more thing mainly important in a system is a storage unit, or you can say why the computer has evolved so much is because of the capacity to store. Of course, the rest of the things are important, but there are no much, you know, difference from the first generation to fourth generation that has been there. Because input devices, most of the time the keyboard itself, output is again the monitor or the printer. So there are not much difference. Of course, the individual input devices have been improved. Like the keyboard what we get now is not what we used to get 10 years ago or 20 years ago. So individually it has been evolved, but still those are the just keyboards. But the storage unit is not that way. It's like it is divided into two things, that is primary memory and secondary memory. And in this, we have seen the memories used in a different generation of computers were so different. So what is primary memory? Primary memory is nothing but the memory that actually stores your current information or the commands that you have given. It can be like, you know, the operating system, or what the operating system has to do, or the commands that you give to the operating system, that what it has to do with the system. So all this comes under primary memory. It is comparatively costly, and it is very fast. And because of this primary memory, only the computer works in the sense the immediate information processing is done because of this primary memory. Secondary memory is nothing but, we know, once we do something on the system, or we have to save it in the system, we save it in the secondary memory. It can be like, you know, the hard disk that you have in the system. See, whenever you actually perform some task on the system, your result or whatever the information you are getting, it is output. It is not stored in the secondary memory. First, it will be there in the primary memory. Then, when you have done everything and when you give the save, usually you give the save button or save option in many of the tasks that you perform on a system. So then it goes to the secondary memory and stays there. And even when the power goes off and you turn it on the next time, you get this information because it's stored in the secondary memory. Secondary memory is comparatively slow compared to the primary memory. Why? Because it is we don't have information to be processed so fast because it is only used for storing. And one more thing is, because it is slow, it's a comparatively even cheaper when compared to primary memory. So these are the components of our computer system, and there is a block diagram in here where you have the input unit, the central processing unit, which consists of registers, control unit, arithmetic logic unit, and we have the output device. Whereas the central processing unit is connected to the storage unit. You can see there are two types of arrow marks in this diagram. That is, one shows the instruction flow and one shows the data flow. See, instruction flow, it comes from the input. We all know the user has to give the input. Then that instruction is going in the form of data to the central processing unit, and it goes to the various parts in the central processing unit, like control unit and arithmetic and logic unit. And once the result has been stored, or we get the results, one copy is like stored in your storage device, and one more thing of the data, that is the output data, is going to the output device. So this is how we get the task that have been done in a system from input to output. The user gets the task done with the system.